Hello students, I am Dr. K. Sarojini Chakravarti, working as assistant professor in the Department of Botany, Government Degree College, Khairtabad, Hyderabad. In today's class, we will continue with mutations. So in the last class, we have seen what are mutations, what is the significance of mutation, what are the different types of mutations, and we have seen what is the classification of mutations. And in that we have seen induced mutations. In induced, again two tests, spontaneously induced and induced mutations. Induced mutations are of two types, that is, which are caused by physical mutagens, there is X-rays, beta rays, gamma rays, UV rays, etc. And there, and because of chemical mutagens, and we have seen six different types of chemical mutagens and what they cause. Okay. After that, we have seen spontaneous mutations, which occur spontaneously. These are of two types: chromosomal aberrations and gene mutations. In chromosomal aberrations, if the changes occurs in the number of chromosomes and the changes occurs in the structure of the chromosome. So last class we have seen the structural changes in a chromosome, which consists of four different ways, which occurs in four different ways. One is deletion, duplication, inversions and translocations. So in this class we are going to see the second category of chromosomal aberrations, that is changes in number of chromosomes. So in chromosomal aberrations, the second one is numerical changes or changes in the number of chromosomes. Okay, so last class we have seen there is a change in the structure of chromosome. So in this class we are going to see this change in the number of chromosomes. So, if there is a change in the number of chromosomes, it occurs in two ways. Changes in sets of chromosomes, that is euploids, and changes in number of few chromosomes, that is aneuploids. So, what is aneuploidy? Aneuploidy is nothing but where chromosome complement, it differs from normal by part of chromosome set. So, that is known as aneuploidy. So, what does it mean? So, there is a change in chromosome number to its a simple basic number. Okay, so there is a change in chromosome number to its simple basic number, and these are called aneuploids. So if an organism contains one or more incomplete set of chromosomes, then it is called as aneuploids. Okay, so now we'll see how they are categorized. Aneuploid is divided into two types. One is hypoploidy, hyperploidy. Hypoploidy is again, it is divided into two: monosomy, that is 2n-1. Another one is nullisomy, that is 2n-2. Hyperploidy is divided into two: trisomy, that is 2n+1, and tetrasomy, that is 2n+2. Okay, now we'll see each one. So what is hypoploidy? Aneuploids deficiency with more number of chromosomes. So there is a deficiency of chromosome. So that's why they are known as hypoploids. So what are hyperploids? So we can see here plus symbol is there. So if plus symbol is there, what does it mean? If they contain one or more chromosomes extra to its original complement, then they are called as hyperploids. So here it is deletion of one or more chromosomes to its original complement in hypoploidy. And when you come to hyperploidy, there is a addition of one or more chromosomes extra to its original complement, that are hyperploid. That's why plus symbol is given, plus one and plus two. Okay, so now we'll see each one and how it will be. So if monosome is 2n-, so what does it mean? If a haploid with one chromosome deficient from its normal complement, then it is known as monosomics or monosomy, that is 2n-1. And in hypoploidy, the second one is nullisomy or nullisomic. If a pair of homologous chromosomes are lost from its normal complement, then it is called nullisomy, the 2n-. So one pair of chromosome is lost here. And when you come to hyperploidy, trisomy, so here an extra chromosome, it contains extra chromosome to its normal complement, then it is known as trisomy, a 2n+1. If a pair of homologous chromosome is added to its normal complement, So one pair is added, that is plus 2. That's why it is known tetrasomy, that is 2n plus 2 condition will be there. Okay. Next is euploidy. So what is euploidy? The organism should possess one or more full sets of chromosomes. Then it is known as euploidy. So euploidy is again divided into three types: monoploidy, diploidy, polyploidy. Monoploidy is X, denoted as X. Diploidy is 2X. Polyploidy is 3X, 4X, 5X, etc. So poly means many. It goes on. So haploids can be artificially produced by any of the following methods. First one is X-ray treatment. Second one is delayed pollination. Third one is temperature shocks. Fourth one is colchicine treatment. Fifth one is interspecific or intergeneric hybridization. Last is anther or pollen culture. So through these we can produce somatic haploids artificially. Now we'll see polyploidy in detail. So what is polyploidy? As I said, the plant contains more than two gametes, and they are number of multiple sets of basic sets of chromosomes present, then they are called as polyploids. So examples I have given, it is a 3x, 4x, 5x, 9x, it goes on. And it is of three types, that is autopolyploids, allopolyploids, segmental allopolyploids. So polyploids arise because of two processes. One is due to irregular mitosis. Somatic cell spindle disturbances takes place, thereby resulting in entire doubling of the chromosome set. That is one way of having a polyploids. The second way is irregularities in meiosis. It results in the formation of unreduced gametes. So again, it results in the formation of polyploids. So because of these two processes, polyploids generally occurs in nature. And as I said, polyploidy is of three types: autopolyploids, allopolyploids, segmental allopolyploids. So many ornamental plants are polyploids. Many angiosperms, ferns, mosses, conifers are often polyploids. And polyploid is very rare in animals. So polyploidy is very common in plants, but it is very rare in animals. Now we'll see each one. The first one is autopolyploids. So these autopolyploids are formed due to duplication of same genome set of an organism. Suppose, means it is originates within a species. If a diploid species contains two genotypes of same type, that is AA, so autopolyploids, it contains three genomes, that is AAA, so triple A is present. And tetraploids contains four sets, that is a 2 plus 2, that is AA, A and A. So four A's are present. So autotriploid, that is triple A, it is sterile due to formation of aneuploid gametes. And autotetraploid, that is AAAA, it is spontaneous doubling induced by drugs such as colchicine. So here in this picture we can see, this is mitosis in a diploid, that is 2N is equal to 4. Okay, so it has a genotypes of same, that is A and A. In a normal mitosis, you have, two diploid cells are formed. But with colchicine treatment, for one cell division, you can get one tetraploid cell. So like this, when, plants are treated with colchicine, so here polyploids development takes place. Next is allopolyploids. So here, allopolyploids, it results from doubling of chromosome number in hybrid, which is derived from two or more distinctly different species. So here we can take examples of this one. One is Raphanus, where it's a basic chromosome set is 2n is equal to 18. So these are the parents. Another one is Brassica, where 2n is equal to 18 again. But these two are distinctly different species. Okay, they are not related species, they are distinctly different species, distinctly. So here, the two gametes, you'll get n is 9, another n is 9. And what F1 hybrid, what you get is a sterile one. N plus 1, that is 9 plus 1, 18. 2n is equal to 18. but sterile will be there. And from here, when you do go with the Colchicine treatment, you have these next hybrids, Raphanobrassica F2, you have this Raphanobrassica, where it is fertile in nature. And it is 2n plus 2n, which is 18 plus n. So 4n is equal to 36. So that's why it is fertile in nature. So here, in a hybridization technique, so what is happening? Here, hybrid of two or more closely related species or distinctly different species are taken. So what is happening? Partially homologous chromosomes, they take part in this. So here the example is, as I said, Raphanobrassica. So it is an example of amphidiploid. It is an example of amphidiploid. So what is amphidiploid? Here AA, BB are produced. So here if you take, this is AA as a genotype, and this here we take a, as a BB as a genotype, another parent. So Raphanobrassica, the hybrid produces AA and BB, that is amphidiploid in nature. Okay, so there's, in allopolyploids, you know, pairing is autosynodesis type, that is parental or maternal pairing, in contrast to allosynodes, that parental maternal pairing in diploids and autopolyploids. Another example is evolution of wheat. This is a classic example of allopolyploids, where common wheat is hexaploid, 2n is equal to 42, and it is AA, BB, DD genotype. So three diploid genomes are present, that is A, B, and D, which are related to each other. So this is an example of another example in a common cultivated wheat, which is an example for allopolyploid. So as I said, there are three different chromosome numbers in the genus Triticum. 2n is equal to 14, 2n is equal to 48, 2n is equal to 42. So it is a hexaploid. As I said, hexaploid and the three diploid genomes. Okay, so first is first cross is between 2n is equal to 14 and 2n is equal to 40, that is Triticum speltoides and Triticum biaticum. So you'll get a hybrid variety, that is 2n is equal to 14, and you have the genotypes A and B. So you have A, genotypes A and B, AA with BB, you'll get AB. Okay. So this is a wild tetraploid wheat, AA with BB. Now from this you have a cultivated variety, AA and BB with D genome. Okay, DD genome. This is again another wild type. And when you do the crossing over, you'll get a hybrid. The hybrid is, you know, is a hexaploid, because the chromosome doubling has taken place. And you can see the production of hexaploid wheat, that is Triticum aestivum, where it has 2n is equal to 6x, that is hexaploid 6x, and the genomes are AA, BB, and DD. So this is the common wheat what we are eating, that is Triticum aestivum, okay, which is hexaploid in nature. So allopolyploids may be artificially synthesized, so that is because of that we can have this hexaploid wheat. Okay, the common cultivated wheat what we are eating, they are produced because of this artificial cultivation of allopolyploids. Okay, last is segmental allopolyploids. So those some allopolyploids, they contain different genomes. All of them are not totally different and have partial homology between them, and therefore these genera show pairing behavior. Okay, so because of a partial homology, these allopolyploids are called segmental allopolyploids. So there is not much important for this, but in potato, that is Solanum tuberosum, is a good example for segmental allopolyploid. And autopolyploids, they play an important role in evolution of species than these segmental allopolyploids. Next, gene mutations. Gene mutations are also known as point mutations. Okay, so why these are important? Point mutations occur generally at molecular level, and these are caused due to change in nitrogenous bases present in DNA. So you can see a permanent alterations in the sequence of nucleotides in the genetic material. That's why gene mutations or point mutations are very, very important. And moreover, point mutations or gene mutations cannot be reverted back to normalcy in the next generation. Okay, that's why we should be very careful with this alterations in base sequences. And these alterations in base sequences may be of following types, or it occurs because of following types. First one is deletion of bases. Second one is insertion of bases. Third one is inversion of a sequence. Last is replacement of a base pair, that is substitution. We'll see each one. So deletion, insertion, inversion, it includes changes in base sequences involving breakage and reunion of DNA segments. That is regarding deletion, insertion, and inversion gene mutations. Okay. The last is that is replacement or substitution. Replacement of a base pair takes place during replication of DNA without any breakage of DNA. So what is the difference between the first three and the last one is the first three, in the first three, where you can see the changes occurs because of it involves breakage and reunion of DNA segments. But when you come to the last one, like substitution or replacement, here the base pair takes place during replication of DNA without any breakage of DNA. So we are more concentrating on the last one, that is substitution. So substitution mutations, it occurs in the substitution of one nitrogen base for the other, and it occurs in two ways, that is transitions and transversion. So what are transitions? If purine is replaced by another purine, if pyrimidine is replaced by another pyrimidine, then they are known as transitions. It means if AT is replaced by GC, then it is known as transition. Okay, next one is transversions. Okay, so what does it mean? Here, purine is replaced by pyrimidine and pyrimidine is replaced by purine, vice versa. It means like CG, that is cytosine and guanine, is replaced by guanine and cytosine. Adenine and thymine is replaced by thymine and adenine. Okay, so this is known as transversions. So in transitions, purine is replaced by another purine. And when you come to transversions, here purine is replaced by pyrimidine. Purine is replaced by pyrimidine. That is transversions. Okay. So, what are purines? A and G, adenosine and adenine and guanosine or guanine are purines. Thymine and cytosine are pyrimidines. Okay. Now we'll see transition, how it occurs. Transition, it occurs in three ways. One is incorporation of base analogs. The second one is deamination. And third one is frameshift. First, we'll see incorporation of base analogs. So, what are transitions? When purine is replaced by purine and pyrimidine is replaced by pyrimidine. Okay. Now, we'll see how it occurs in the incorporation of base analogs. So, if you see in this one, okay. So, this is the effect of the 5-bromouracil can pair with adenine like thiamine. So effect of enol form of 5-bromouracil during incorporation of base analogs. So what is the first one base analog what we are taking is G and C, guanine and cytosine. In first replication, what G has to be paired with? G has to be paired with G with C. Okay. Okay, so 5-bromouracil can pair with A just like a thiamine. Okay, so when instead of here A, what I said like transitions, A is, you know, it is replaced by another purine, that is G. So here instead of having this one, you have a bromouracil. And again, second replication takes place and A is paired with again bromouracil. and in the third replication A is again paired with bromouracil. So therefore, ultimately what you have is A is, you know, GC is, you know, it is replaced with AT, and AT here it is replaced by GC, or total AT is, you know, replaced by GC. So occasionally 5-bromouracil it loses a hydrogen atom in position and it pairs with G instead of A. So that is happening in incorporation of base analogs. So 5-bromouracil, as it loses a hydrogen atom in position and it pairs with G, that is guanine, instead of A. So it is pairing with guanine instead of A. So that's why, like this, you know, in each replication, instead of this one, bromouracil is, it is, you know, it is pairing with adenine or adenosine. So this is regarding incorporation of base analogs. Next is deamination. So what is deamination? Nitrous acid HNO2 deaminates the bases guanine, cytosine, and adenosine. Okay, so it means nothing but it is removing the amino group. So because of these reactions, adenine is converted to hypoxanthine, cytosine is converted to uracil, and similarly guanine is, you know, converted, changed to xanthine. So here, because of this nitrous acid deamination or removing the amino group, adenosine is, you know, changed to hypoxanthine. And this hypoxanthine, it pairs with cytosine. Thus, nitrous acid, it brings changes from AT to GC due to deamination of A2H. So very clearly we can see, as, you know, adenosine, it is, you know, because of removal of amino group, it is changed to hypoxanthine, that is H. And this H, hypoxanthine, it pairs with cytosine. And thus, because of this, there is a change from AT to GC due to deamination of adenosine to hypoxanthine, that is deamination. So in this picture, very clearly we can see. So because of this, normal base adenine is altered to hypoxanthine, and this hypoxanthine, it is paired with G, with C, that is cytosine, and you'll get this one. Okay, A to GC transformation has taken place. In cytosine, when is the normal base, because of, you know, removal of amino group, it goes changed to uracil, and this uracil is, you know, this it is paired with G, that is guanine, and G is paired with C, and this uracil is paired with adenosine. So because of that, there is a change from GC to AT, and here AT to GC. So there is an alteration in the pairing has occurred. Last is frame shift mutation. So what are frame shift? What is frame shift mutation? Inserting or deleting one or more nucleotides induced by arachidonic dyes is known as frame shift mutation. It changes the reading frame, like changing a sentence. That's why it is known as frame shift mutation. So there is a movement in the change in the shift in the frame of a nucleotide, and that's why it is known as frame shift mutation. And proteins built incorrectly, because of this shift, the proteins are built incorrectly. So here, this is a normal nucleotide sequence. Okay, this is before mutations, and this is after mutation. So there is an insertion. So actually, what the proteins they have to be read? They have to be read as methionine, arginine, THR, and phenylalanine. Okay, because of this shift in insertion, and there is addition of nucleotide or nucleotide base. So what happened? There is a shift in the frame of the sequence. So after methionine, instead of getting arginine, you are getting serine. So, and there is a, next is tyrosine. After that, there is leucosine. So there is a change in the proteins. So there is a change in the amino acids. This is regarding insertion. If there is a deletion in the you know, sequence, okay, nucleotide sequence, what happens? If there is a deletion in the nucleotide sequence also, what happens? The first three are same. There is no change. That is methionine is there. But after methionine, instead of getting arginine, what you get is valine. Okay, another, it was read into another amino acid. Next is proline. So there is a change. So that's why there is a shift in the, or there is a change in the nucleotide sequence, and that's why it is known as frame shift mutations. Now we'll see what are the different chromosomal abnormalities which occurs because of chromosomal aberrations. If there is addition or a deletion of a chromosome number. Okay. So in human beings, it causes different genetic disorders. The first one is Kreidler-Katz syndrome. Okay, it's a deletion of the long arm of chromosome 5. Next is Down syndrome, trisomy 21. Edwards syndrome, trisomy 18. Means 18th chromosome, you have addition of one more. That is trisomy. Last is Patau's syndrome, which is trisomy 13. At the 13th chromosome, one more addition is there. Turner syndrome, that is X0. So it's a monosomy, it's a minus 1, 45X. Okay. Klinefelter syndrome, that is XXY, trisomy 47. So this X chromosome, you have one more extra chromosome is there. So these are the different, because of Down syndrome, actually most of the people you might have seen this Down syndrome and Kreidler-Katz syndrome, means when they cry, the sound is similar like a cat, and this is Patau's syndrome. So that's why, because of this chromosomal aberrations, there is a syndrome. It causes syndromes in the human beings. Okay, so this syndrome is genetically it has poor and goes to the next generation. It may or may not be passed to the next generation. But in the generation when they have any deletion or insertion of a chromosome, it results in these kind of syndromes. In the next class, we'll go with another topic in cell biology.